Welcome to the CESS meeting. Today is July 27th of 2022. Today we're going to talk about modules for, and that's probably where we start for the rest of CESS meetings for a long while. And we have a couple of topics today. Carity and Niccolo have both started writing spec text below or around layer zero of this epic for modules. So I'm going to turn the floor over to Carity. And then after we have, after we've gotten up to date on where the spec text development has gotten so far, we're going to talk about import meta and whether to use import meta as a stand-in for module referrers or not. So yeah, go ahead, Carity.
Okay, let me share my screen here. So where we are right now, so we have two separate pull requests. One thing that we exclusively focus on layer zero, this one here. One thing that Niccolo and I found, probably Niccolo has more info on this, is that the spec right now is very hand-waving when it comes to the module system and integration with the host. There's a bunch of different host operations that are used throughout the spec in order to do certain pieces of the work and so on. So there is a desire, I would say, for a refactor there to take ownership, I would say, take ownership in the sense of having specific text describing the operations in 262 rather than just being hand waving. So this is the current pull request from Niccolo. It basically reduces, I believe it reduces the host operation to one host operation or two, something like that. It refactors a bunch of things in the spec that will help us to accommodate some of the new proposals related to module Harmony. These pull requests can come in now or later, doesn't really matter. And for that reason, the spec that I have been working on with the help of Niccolo now is specifically about layer zero and is assuming that this will not land the refactor, but is crafted in a way that if this lands, we can make simple changes to just accommodate to this refactor. But we don't know yet what the timing will be in terms of what goes first. And we don't want to depend on other refactors or things like that to continue advancing this. So this is the layer zero. You can get it from the pull request. There's a link here to get the rendered version of it. Layer zero is specifically adding the module constructor, the module source constructor, and changing the semantics of the import, dynamic import, to accept a module instance. That's pretty much what layer zero is. When you go into the details of these, there are just a few things that I wanted to mention. The source text module record now has a back pointer to a module instance, which is basically an instance of the module constructor. It could be undefined because all the things that the browser would do, this property will be undefined there. This field will be undefined.
Well, hold on. I'm suddenly very confused. The source text module record can be instantiated multiple times. So there can be multiple module instances for a given source text module record. So the module record is supposed to only have the static information. I don't understand how I can point at a module instance.
This is the old one. No. This is the source
text. This is the current spec. This is what it is right now in 262. Yes.
Thank you.
Yeah, we will do all kind of refactors on top of these.
I got it. This is what you're fixing. Yeah.
The thing that we have been trying to go with, or the idea, the tactic that we're using right now is make the least amount of changes in 262 so we can land this, and then we can make all kind of refactors to make it nicer. So we're trying to only touch in very specific places so we can get this in, and then we can get someone to do a more proper refactor of the records and the spec in general.
And I think it would be coherent with the strategy if independently we got a refactor in before, but we're not going to depend upon it. And we don't want to signal that we are dependent upon a refactor in order to make progress.
Yep. So this back pointer is optional in the sense that you can have module records that will have it, and some module records will not have it. So aside from that, this is just an artifact. I will not even touch on it. Think about this as a subset of what the module source text record has in terms of static information about the parse source. So it's not super important. The runtime semantics of the import and the evaluation for the import syntax, the dynamic import, will now have a few new lines that will check if the thing that you're providing is either a specifier or a module. And it does that by checking if the module has a module source internal slot, it means it is a module instance. If it is a module instance, then we do something completely different to what we do when it comes to doing the string value that has a referral, and so a referral in terms of the script module. So it's a different approach. Nicole and I agree that this probably should not be a host operation, but it depends on the refactor. Once we get the refactoring, then we can drop this host operation. For now, it's a host operation. So I'm waving, saying, hey, host, this is what you should do when you encounter this. These are the steps that you have to do to the success path and the failure path. Eventually, we want to specify that better. But for now, again, we're going with what we have right now. In terms of the module source constructor, is very easy. This is only grabbing that, parsing at the moment that you create the instance, and then keeping that in there for a while until you actually need to get the pieces out of the source map, the module source. In terms of the big one, which is the module objects,
May I ask a clarifying question? Do we, in the spec text is written, separate the notion of a module source instance, the one that's an instance of the module source intrinsic, from a module source record? Or are they one and the same?
In terms of, can you repeat that question?
For module sources, are we, in this spec text as written, are there separate layers for the spec fiction of a module source record from the module instance? That's just one.
No, in fact, we could make it a single one. Like we could have those internal slots into the module source instance itself, rather than having a record associated to it. I put it in a record because eventually we might do the refactor.
Oh, so you mean you did separate the record from the instance?
Yeah, when you create
good.
That's a construction good. Here, like basically we create the ordinary object out of the constructor, and then we have one internal slot. In that internal slot, we store the parse module source, which is the new thing that is a subset of the source text module record.
This is good because it's important for later layers and interaction with WebAssembly. I think that what we're
I could move it all here, but I think it's just a bunch of things that you see in this table here. All these things, we can put it directly into that, but I keep it separate for now.
Don't keep it separate. Separate's
so
good.
One thing before getting into the weeds of the module object, one thing that I feel that is important, or I feel that it helps to understand better. And we still have some struggles there, I believe. But one thing that is important is that there is a distinction between a dynamic dependency and a static dependency. So dynamic dependency is something that you use through the import, dynamic import. A static one is declarations of dependencies that you have that are figured out during parsing. It turns out, and maybe it's clear for some, but it wasn't clear for me from the beginning, is that if you are a module, an instance of a module, whether you were created by using the module block or by doing new module or whatever form, or using the module reflection, whatever form that you ended up being a module instance, your dependencies has to be module instances. Because during the resolution of that, you need to figure out that those are module instances. It turns out that the, I'm getting confused myself, or let me step back for a second. You have a module that has dependencies, and you have a module that might have dependence on. When it comes to dependencies, we need to find a way that resolves to a module record that is sufficient for us to continue the creation of the module graph. But when it comes to being a dependent of another module, you can only be a dependent of a module instance. And that seems to me that is an invariant. And this invariant is important because it prevents cycles between modules that are, and I'm talking exclusively about static dependencies. It precludes the creation of cycles between a module record to a module record without an associated module instance to a module record with an associated module instance. Kind of, it's not possible in what we're trying to expect here. And it wasn't clear for me from the very beginning. And I don't know if we eventually will be able to resolve this problem. Not a problem, it is an invariant of what we're doing right now. And the reason why it's an invariant is because if you take control of a module instance, so you have the module instance, you control the hook, you can do the resolution of the things. You can always determine what is the dependency that you will resolve to. But if you are a module created by the browser, module instance, a module record created by a browser, and you do not have a module instance associated to it, you don't have a hook. Therefore, you cannot resolve to another module instance, so a module record associated to a module instance. Does that make sense?
I'm following.
So this
basically, the module records are the bedrock that we're building on top of, and module instances are a layer on top of that that isn't necessarily evenly distributed. So we have to use module records for linkage, right?
Right, right. So that's important. Module records, the linkage currency, I would say. Getting into this, maybe we'll step back to that again, but I think it's important that there is this restriction. And I think the importance is that when you're building a sub-module graph, because someone creates a module instance and provides a hook, and then that hook has to resolve to another module instance and provide the hooks for it, and so on, we might get to the point where we resolve to a module instance that has a hook that is a default behavior of the browser, that resolve to dependencies that the browser will handle, and those will not be instances anymore. We don't have a solution for that yet. In this respect, we don't have a solution for that. There is an explicit assumption here that you have to go module instance all the way down. And we need to find a solution where we can escape that and say, oh, wait, at this point on, the resolution is no longer about instances that call in an input hook. We already have all that covered. We only have a record and we go with that record. So that doesn't, it's not covered by this, but I don't think it's difficult to do. Well, I was talking to,
right,
Nicole about it, but we need to figure that out.
My intuition is that Nicola already has a solution for this problem, but it's of the shape, And we've talked a little bit about it before, but I think that what it means is going into module record and making explicit that it has a host import behavior as not a virtualizable hook, but as a host provided hook by default, that we would be able to provide an alternative to when it's backed by a user.
Right. So we have it already. It's specified here in the constructor here. So what we're doing is that we are creating an function that we keep it in the instance of the module. This internal function by default, when you go through the constructor, is going to be a closure that expect and specifier capture the input hook and the input meta, and then what it does is just calling the hook. This abstract operation, this closure is when you go through new module. But if you go and define the module via module block, the module block runtime semantics can define its own input hook, a different one, that is a default one. But that's not the problem. The problem is that when we go into the specification of how, let me go back here.
It's basically that it has to be punched one layer down from where it is right now, right? But the import hook needs to go down to the module record and can't just be a facility of module instances.
See if I have the latest one here, because I think it's not the latest one. The problem that we see with this, the problem that we see with this is that we're specifying that the host has to go very deep into the module graph by using resolve module record dependency. And resolve module record dependency is already saying that you must have an input hook, and you need to resolve to a thing that is a module instance. So this is the problem. But again, we'll figure it out. I don't think it's super important right now to go into the detail of that. But
agreed.
To have that mental model that you should be able to build a subtree in the module graph that at some point, some of the dependencies that you have should be controlled by the host. And you should not have to create all the way down module instances as it is right now. Another thing that we did is the source, and this is coming from Niccolo, the source getter on a module instance might return null. And it might return null because you might use a module reflection, or you might use some other ways to create an instance that has no source associated to it, or the source is not useful. You should not be able to grab a arbitrary source and create more instances out of a module instance that you have access to. So for now, we have it. It could be an instance of a module source, or it could be null. That's the current specification here.
Yeah, and to be clear, my feeling is that for import reflection and for module blocks and module fragments, in all of the cases where it's possible to construct a reasonable module source, we should. But for something that's a built-in module like the file system and node, that we have no expectation that you'd be able to get the source. And that might also apply to virtualized module sources. It might not be reasonable to pass this through.
So this is the note about that. So it's just saying that FS is a good example, as you said, it's a good example of things that will not have a source. You might use a reflection to get the module instance out of it, but it will not have a source associated with it. So you will not be able to create more than one. Okay, so that's pretty much it. Not much here. Changes are minimum. And most of it is just additive to what we have. A few things to resolve, but I think it's looking good.
This actually brings, this is a bit of a tangent, but there's a pattern that I expect to occur where module instances are constructed Is it just reframing it in terms of the current ideas that there you might create a module instance using an evaluator such that the source actually depends on a particular set of globals being in the global scope in order for it to do its job? Like if you were emulating the creation of the FS module, you might actually have a source, but that source is useless to you unless you evaluate it inside of an evaluator that provides it with the powers it needs to do its job, in which case it might be sensible to make have a mechanism for ensuring that such instances don't have a source, which I haven't thought of before. I'll think about that some more.
I did not understand that. Ensuring that such instances don't have a source.
If you were to construct a new module from a module source that is useless without a particular evaluator, then there's no good reason to have a source property on that module instance because it wouldn't be multiply instantiable from an arbitrary location.
I gotcha. Okay.
Yeah. I don't think there's no harm for this source being there. It's just inert code, but it might be good to provide a mechanism for constructing module instances that don't have source properties associated with them, or flipping the bits so that you have to explicitly associate the source if you want that behavior.
I think what we discussed, Mark, could be that in my import hook, I might get the specifier and the import meta, and I might want to return the reflection of FS. We can do FS here with the syntax, which I don't remember the syntax.
Let's say module colon true.
Module
true. Let's pretend that's what's proposed.
Something like that. And so this thing that you return from here, obviously is a promise to FS, but the FS is going to be a module instance that has no source, because if it has a source, then you should be able to do these, grab the source and create a new instance of FS. And FS is a built-in, so browsers don't want that. It's only one instance of FS.
Okay. Well, let's proceed, Carity.
Okay. Okay. So that's pretty much it about the where we are right now. So we're still making quite some changes here, but again. Looking good, very simple, not a lot of code here. So you had a chance to just take a look at it, and we can go from there. So I don't know if Nicolo has anything to add here. Nicolo, go ahead.
I'm happy with how you present all of this.
Yeah, can you tell us a little bit about the refactoring that you're building?
Yes, sure. Cardi, can you show it for us? Thank you.
It's here.
So, currently, there are. Okay.
I think we can. Let me get you to the whole operation so we can see the.
Yes. So currently, when you import a module, there are three things that happen. First, the host has to walk the module graph while loading all the dependencies, and the host has to load all the dependencies before calling back into 262. Then 262 has a link operation that walks again through the graph and synchronously asks to the host about all the resolved modules. And this can happen synchronously with host resolved imported module only because the host already loaded everything before calling back into 262.
And this is That's a question that I asked you, Chris, and we were like, what's going on here? And it's a realization when Nicolo explained to me how it works, like this is a realization. They do all these things twice. They do it prepare all the module records, that they do all the stuff by calling into our ASRAC operations. They build that thing and then they go and call the, it's like a, not a verification process, but it's just like, okay, go and do the thing now. But assuming that everything is synchronously available because they already expired all the module grab and they expanded to be ready. And then they go through the process that we have specified, which is, okay.
To be clear, the SESSHIM does all of those things too, in exactly the same way.
So, okay. And then we traverse the graph a third time to actually evaluate the modules. There are two places where this asynchronous loading happens. One is like from in a browser when you have a script tag and the browser sees the script tag, loads all the things asynchronously, and then calls link. And when we have a dynamic import, we needed this host import module dynamically hook because we need to tell the host to do its async stuff, and then we can go back to SUSE 2. What I'm doing is that I'm taking ownership of this async loading part by moving it to a new. So currently modules have a link and an evaluate method. I'm introducing a third like load dependencies method that walks the graph. And for every dependency, it asks the host to load that single dependency as an unlinked module record. And everything else that was handled by the browser would now by the host would now be handled by 262. And this is important for us because it lets us, like, having the unlinked module record is the most simple thing we can ask to the host, because then the host only has to actually load the module record and to give it to us without doing any other work.
This also gives us a place to put the import hook.
Yes. And I wanted to do this for module blocks because I wanted to be able to import a module block without asking the browser, how do I need to import this module block? So I import the module block, then if it has some external dependencies, I want to ask the browser only about those external dependencies. And this is also important for the layer zero of compartments because, as Cardi showed, we need that host hook that to let the host handle calls to the import hook. With this refactor, we could handle all of that internally in 262. So instead of adding a new host hook for every proposal, we would be able to always reduce a single host hook.
And this refactor is non-normative, correct?
I'm not fully sure. Because it might change the number of micro tasks yeah. between things. But since we're talking about networks, it's not observable. It's like, I mean, networks are not reliable from a timing point of view, so it probably would not be observable. It's surely not observable like only within a program. So yes, it's probably non-normative.
Networks themselves, of course, are not a concept that come up in the spec.
Yes, so, what I mean is that. Okay, so what I'm currently doing is that I have an import cache, and for every imported dependency, I store that in a map stored in the module record, so that. We do not need anymore the requirement that host resolve imported module always return the same module record for different things. And this means that when we do a dynamic import, if the dependency was already loaded for that specific file, we just get it from the cache. And so we now have a single promise tick because we already had the module. While earlier that was host defined because we always called the host import module dynamically hook.
Yeah, and this is important. Thanks for mentioning. This is another change that this build right now, the cache is all hand waving. We tell the browser when to cache. We don't say how to cache. And this brings back to 262 the caching mechanism for all this, whether that's the browser doing the fetching and all that, or whether it's the user doing that. It's the same cache mechanism.
So let me hypothesize how it might be normative, and you can tell me if this is right. It sounds like we're reducing the degrees of freedom, that there are some things where with the new spec, we could say something about what the turn delay is, where in the old spec, it was much more just up to the host. The host had more freedom. The host could act in such a way as to be compatible with the new spec, but the host could act in, but the host also could act in such a way with the old spec that the new spec would not allow. Is that correct?
I think so.
Okay, yes, so that is normative. If all of the hosts act in a way, already are known to act in a way that's consistent with the new spec, then it's, you know, it's not normative in a burdensome way, but it is a normative difference.
Right. So to dig a little bit deeper, if the only way that an existing implementation could defer from the behavior that we're specifying is to have more ticks than one, I think that that's non-normative. If it can have fewer ticks than we're specifying, then it might be.
Why is it not normative if the old spec it could have more than one, and the new spec it cannot?
Because the only difference is going to be whether it's cached or not cached, and the only behavior where it could defer, where a host could defer, is if they could avoid having even one microtask, that right?
Right. I think you're right. If they figure a way to synchronously do something that we will specify as you need a tick,
at least. Oh, so this is the opposite direction of what I was thinking. I was thinking that the old spec allows the host to take longer, and the new spec.
Yeah, the current spec allows it to take this more than one tick, right? It's a host hook that defers and the implementation observes the a promise completion, which means that there must be at least one tick.
Okay.
In the previous version of this, in the current version of the spec, it defers the entire load process to a host hook. And does it currently, do we currently observe the result of that through a promise completion, or is it possibly synchronous?
I don't think you can measure micro like ticks with static import. So it's only with dynamic import, and that always returns a promise.
Yeah.
We might be fine. I think we're fine.
I think we're fine, but we should, you know, make sure that nobody else thinks that this is a normative change if we want to try to land it as a non-normative change.
Yeah. So I think the thing to do is to alert people to this issue as well as our reasoning about it, rather than just assuming it away. But you know, yeah, this is a hazard. Somebody else might have some reason to worry about it.
And the worst case, in the worst case, this refactor has to wait to plenary. And I don't,
And this refactor already has to wait for not approval, but at least the HTML editors must be happy with this. And so it's still something that we need to, that probably takes as much.
Yes, plenary. Plenaries happen frequently these days. Yes. Okay, cool. Well, I'm excited about both of these changes in progress. I am very excited about, I hope that we layer this with Carides on top of your change, Niccolo, because I think that it makes it easier to punch down. Yep. to the module record layer for the import hook. But yeah, so that gives us a few minutes.
One more thing.
Yeah.
So I have a draft spec of module blocks on top of MatterFactor. And so the part of importing a module block is probably very similar to what it's needed for layer zero. So I could actually try as an experiment to see how well MatterFactor works to add the missing loading pieces to called import hook and see how it looks.
Yeah, let's do that.
Sounds wonderful. I mean, this is, so I'm not well versed in reading or writing 262 yet. And for me, the next step is obviously doing that for the rest of the compartments proposal, but having not just one, but two people doing that work in parallel is strictly better in my opinion. yeah. So let's take it to import meta. So there's an open question, and I think, Nicole, it's good to have you here too, because I think it's an open question that affects module blocks as well, as to whether we can use the import meta as a stand-in for the referrer, or whether we should have a way to express the referrer for a module instance separately from the import meta.
Yeah, just to be pedantic, not just whether we can use the module, the import meta as the referrer, but whether we should.
Right. And this touches on the issue of module instance serializability. So by way of background, there are kind of three layers implied to what is currently in the spec, a single layer. A module record has the source, which could be a single layer on its own. It has a referrer, which could be the source and the referrer, which could be a layer on their own. And then the source referrer, and then the linkage, which is effectively what we have in a module record today.
Yeah. Before we get into that, so just to clarify what it is today, so we can talk about what it is today and what will need to change. So what it is today, when you create a module, you are supposed to provide an import hook and an import meta object. That import meta object, you can see it here, is only be used, it must be an object, and it'll only be used to create what we call the custom import meta, which is basically a user import.meta. This is what the source code will give you access to by doing import.meta. And this thing is quite interesting because the only thing that it does is basically object.assign. Think about it as an object.assign. It gets the pieces out of it. It creates a new object and store it there. So when the user attempt to use the runtime semantics for import.meta, they get access to this thing. And I think that part will remain the same. This is not the discussion. I believe it's not about this part of the discussion.
No.
It's about the other part, which is the second area where this import meta is used, which is to call the hook. When you call the hook, you pass it as a second argument, that object that was given to you. That's the only place where that object is being used beyond taking the pieces out of it during the creation time. So far, so good?
So I want to just put a flag down that I think where I would like to go would end up without the property copying. So I don't want to simply agree with the property copying, but I certainly agree that it's secondary after we resolve the other issues.
So let's go back. Let's just finish that first. So the reason why the copy is needed is because there are two host operations today that are used to create the module, the import.meta, two operations. One of them is this one, host finalize import. Let me actually find it in the actual 262, so it's easier. So the way it is built right now in the current spec is when you do import.meta in the source, runtime semantics, it will first create what it's called the host get input meta property. So it gets the property. This is what has all the data. And then it calls this other thing that is host specific as well, saying, hey, this is the data that we have constructed, the values that we have constructed. Try to go ahead and do, by the way, this is, I think this is incorrect. This is fine, it's fine. So we put it in meta. So after that, it will call another host saying, this is the object that we have been able to construct with the properties for this module. Go and do the extra bit. So there are two operations. One of them is supposed to create the values that are associated to that object. The other one is for the host to maybe do some extra host specific behavior, like internal slots, adding things to it. I don't know what kind of things the host will need, but this is basically a two steps process.
We should probably, like my understanding is that the host finalize import meta operation should have no observable effect to user code who have access to the import meta. But right. Nicolo is raising a hand and shaking his head at the same time. So take it away.
So I think, Carly, can you show again the part in your spec where you build the import meta object?
Which one?
The part in your spec where you build the import meta object, where you copy the properties.
Oh, here.
Okay, so first of all, host finalize import meta can be observable. So for example, it can attach a prototype or define some getters on the import meta object. And I think that using it here is a problem because we need to be able to virtualize it. And
right. But to that extent, it feels to me that the browsers are doing more than what we tell them to do here. Because here it says very specifically that don't use this one to do the things that you describe. Do it in the other one, the previous one, this one. Host get import meta properties.
No, the reason we have two hooks is because just copying properties was not enough and host needed to do more complex transforms to the import meta object.
Like adding an accessor is not something that can be done with property copy,
yes.
Right? Yeah, that's problematic.
So like the only requirement we have for this, like we have no requirements for this host finalize import meta hook. We just say that it's better if you do not need to use this hook, because if you just need some like normal properties, you just need the host get import meta properties hook. So it's better if you do not need host finalize import meta, but we give this to host because they might need to do more special things.
Okay, so that's good info. I think we might be able to make this a little bit more. I think it's important to keep the two steps. Even when you virtualize, saying one step is to define the things that are observable by the user. The other one is to do the things that the browser does internal stuff, which we don't care much. It's not observable to the user. The user cannot do anything extra with the methods that was given to this object that was given to it. And maybe we can keep that. I don't know if the browsers really need that extra hook to do more things that are not observable.
Browser don't need it. I think it's used by
don't need it. You say don't need it?
Browser HTML uses only host get import meta properties. I think it's used by Node.js or some other server side runtime.
So I think we can figure that out. But again, this is a the part that it is about constructing the import meta object in a virtualized way. We know, I think we are all in agreement that we need a way to virtualize that. And we can make changes, but I think the problem that Mark wants to get into it is the other problem. Like,
yeah,
why do we call the hook import hook with what?
We should revisit. So we should come back and revisit this issue, because it seems to me that the only way to fully virtualize the behavior that Niccolo describes would be to have a pass-through object. And as Mark has mentioned, which is to say that the import meta that's received by the module constructor would be passed through as the value that is seen as import.meta. I think that's less surprising too.
I don't think it will be possible for two reasons. The predictability aspect of it, like if you give a pass through object, that object can be a proxy, can throw, can be rejected, and so on. They don't want that to happen. Maybe on the import, the meta, I don't know. Right now, it's not possible that you do import the meta dot something. It will not fail. It will never fail.
It'll remain the case, though, that we can't virtualize the behavior of attaching an accessor if we're using object-assigned semantics for copying the import meta properties.
Right. No, that part we can fix it. We can make it different kind of thing that allow you to have getters and setters there.
Yeah.
The descriptor or some sort or whatever. I don't know. But that part of...
Let's get back. Like you said, let's get back to the crux of it. Do we need to have a referrer argument on the module constructor that may provide duplicative data with something that's also on import meta, but not in any necessarily prescribed shape?
Well, I think the question is, for me is different. What is a referrer? So it's not really about the second part. About the referral. What is the referral here?
So I would answer that it is a string, and that is the most that we can say about it. Being able to say that it's a string means that it's necessarily serializable, which we can't say of import meta.
And furthermore, that the import hook should have as its second argument that string rather than an import meta.
So a good reason for that would be that we need to maintain the invariant that the referrer does not change between calls to the import hook, right? So being as the import meta is an object that at least the host, the virtualized host can modify at runtime, and that would be observable from call to call of import meta, of the import hook, then it is possible to configure a virtual host in a way where the referrer changes from import to import, which is not desirable.
Why is it a problem if the referrer changes? Because like
I don't see a problem there either, but I think I'm still, you guys are ahead of me. What is the referral? A string value, okay, so I get a source somehow, and I create a module out of it, source and module out of it. And do I need to create some sort of associated source for it? What is that a string value that I had to pass through my input map? Where it's coming from? When I create a new module, will I have to provide the import hook and the import meta and a string value? Is that what you're saying?
That is what we're saying.
And that string value could be anything.
That could be any string, yes. And must be any string, because not every virtual module system uses the same domain, parsable domain for those.
And then you use that string to call the input hook with that string value.
And correct. Only that string value. Yes.
And the two of them. And then in that you resolve to another module instance that when you create it, you also have that source onto it. That source or source.
It would need a referrer, yes.
Mm-hmm. So when you delegate it to
So regardless of this particular design axis, it is the case that an import hook must resolve the import specifier it receives relative to some referrer. So there isn't actually a difference in that case. The distinction is whether the referrer is carried into the import hook on the import meta or associated with the import meta or verbatim as a referrer is the only distinction. Now it turns out that it is also the case that that is the extent of the information that the import hook needs. It will not ever need to see, well, provided that it has a referrer, it will not need to see any property of import meta, any other property
of import meta. So I'm still fussy about how is this different from what we have right now? Like, what is the problem with what we have right now that introducing that extra string value will help?
There are a couple of differences. The only mechanical difference is that the referrer would not be mutable across calls to the import hook. Every time that a particular module instance calls its own import hook, it would always send to the same referrer, and that would be immutable over the lifetime of the module instance. That is a distinction that is desirable. As Niccolo brought up, I don't think that it is fatal if we don't have that invariant, but I think it is desirable.
There's a simplification issue, which is simply, and in fact, a principal least authority issue, which is by giving it only the string and not the import meta, we know that the import hook cannot be, its behavior is not dependent on anything other than the specifier and the referrer string. It's not able to have behavior that's dependent on something else about the import meta.
And then the other potential ramification is that we can guarantee that it is serializable, and that might be relevant to module blocks.
Yeah, and I think it's all just so much easier to explain, right? I mean, the thing that everybody actually needs is the referrer string. The thing that everybody's going to write their input hooks to process is the referrer string. The roundaboutness of trying to explain that by unexplained means, somehow a referrer string can be associated with an import meta, but the particular way to do that is up to the host, and maybe it's in a side table or maybe it's a URL property. It's creating a level of abstraction indirection that I'm all for abstraction indirection when it serves a purpose, but in this case, it's just obscuring what's going on.
Yeah, I disagree with that. I think it's going to be a lot more difficult to implement anything let me try to articulate that better. The reason why import meta is easier is because you will be able to create a hook that is more generic in behavior, because that hook can be used in different module instances that you control, because it only needs to know that I'm going to receive this import meta that contains information and behavior about how to resolve something that I need. If you don't have that, you only receive the string value, that means you have to create an import hook for every instance in order to understand.
So that's not true. That's not true. The referrer is an import hook can be shared across multiple module instances. And
you could do that. But when it comes to creating modules that are different type of modules, so when it is modules that are only source text and you're creating things that are source text and so on, then it might be okay to have a single hook that simply relies on the string value, and then it use that string value to build the URL or the final string, and then use that to look up into a table where you have things that are outside of the hook to do extra things. But I feel that it's going to be, and it might be that we should do the exercise of writing a few examples of these and see how it feels. Because it feels to me that the passing the implementer that you already have to pass anyways, the module instance, is sufficient for a module system that contains various different type of module types. Those that are created from source, those that are virtual created, and so on. And then asking them to have a source that. So here's my
one moment, Carity, a point of order. It's a hard stop for Niccolo at this point, and I wanted to just say thank you for participating. I will share a summary of whatever happens after this moment in Matrix so that
here is the confusing part for me, Mark, and maybe this will help. If I create a module from a source with an input hook, with an input meta, and this magical string value, whatever the value is, what can I do with that magical value in the future that allow me to get access to this module that I just created, or allow me to understand that there is an association between that string value and this module? So this is just a string that I decide
I think I'm not oriented as to who the I is in the question.
As a developer creating a module system, I'm creating a loader.
Okay, creating a module system. Okay.
I decide I will create a new instance of a module. I have a source. I have an import hook. I have an import meta, and now I have to define. Oh, I need to create a unique thing or something that has a meaning for me in terms of what this module means. And I'll pass it into it. The first problem there is like, okay, what is it that I need to pass in? Is it something that I can get from the module source? No, it has to be something that you define as a thing that is associated to the module, but only user land. Like, is the user saying, I have a string associated to you. It could be a number, it could be a zero, whatever I want to pass to you. This is a thing that has a meaning for me because I want the input hook to know about it, so I know who what module is the one calling the hook or something like that, basically.
Okay, so the important distinction that you're begging is that you're suggesting that a single string is not sufficient to make a distinction about resolution in a module system that has a single import hook. Is that correct?
No, we can argue about that. I think it's still possible that you crafted those strings very carefully, and you assign unique strings to every module and yada yada, and you have a composition of these strings to create new strings that will never conflict with existing ones and so on. So you can still do it.
To be clear, as a matter of pedantry, that it is not a guarantee that the referrer is unique per module instance.
The referral is not unique per module instance.
That's right. It is not necessarily the same, not necessarily unique. Like you can, for module blocks, for example, it would definitely not be unique. There could be every module block in the same source is going to have the same referrer.
Oh, when you said not unique, I was misunderstanding which direction you're climbing. Does that make sense?
Yeah. I got confused as well. Yes. Yeah. You can have the same one. I'm not worried about when you do module blocks, because when you do module blocks, this is all transparent to the user. I'm more worried about when you need to create a module from source. A good example would be if I do a module block to get the source, what URL do I use? Or what string do I use? It's just this magical thing that I have to
It's no more magical than import. Import.
No, yeah,
it is less right. Magical than import.
You're right. You probably would be using like import dot meta dot URL or something like that.
Or specific. To be clear, it would be uniform regardless of the shape of import meta. Refer, there would always be a referrer regardless of the shape of import meta. It is import meta that has a shape that varies from host to host.
So then the other problem would be, what if that thing that you, so the, okay, so the only benefit that I see so far is that you will be able to create, you will be able to create, I'm talking about virtualization, you will be able to create a module system that reflects certain URLs via input.meta in the source of the module that has no correspondence whatsoever to the internals of the module system that you build, and how you resolve to that module.
I didn't follow that.
So imagine that I want to get a folder full of modules. I want to build that up, do some bundling or some sort, whatever. And I want to run that code from bundle or from source. And when I run it from source and from bundle, it works the same way. I still get the same input of meta in my code at any level of the module system that I have. It's all always going to be the same, even though the loader is doing a completely different thing to resolve those different bits of the module system.
Mm-hmm.
Because you use that source to resolve the modules and create instances of them, but the input meta is created by the bundler when the bundler is constructing the bundle itself.
Bundling is the perfect use case to describe the distinction. Let me go through this a little bit more in more detail. Import meta has multiple different dimensions pulling on its requirements. And it should be the case that when you take a module graph that is, suppose you have a particular application, right? It's in a package JSON, it starts out on disk in development. And you could, on the one hand, just publish that entire hierarchy with a particular module system and run it on the web, in which case all of those modules would have a sensible import meta URL, right? If you just took the things off disk and then hosted them on a web server, each of those modules, when loaded on the web, would have a sensible import meta URL. When they're loaded on the developer's workstation, they also have a sensible import meta URL, but it is different. It's based off of the physical location on the disk instead of their physical locations on the web. And then furthermore, if you took it off of the disk and then put it in a bundle and then ran it on the web, import meta URL in particular is nonsense. because the purpose of having an import meta URL for something on the web and on the local file system is the ability to use that in order to use URL arithmetic in order to find adjacent physical assets that are not modules, right? You want to be able to say, I new URL, here's a path to my text file or my JSON file or my 3D, my 3D asset, whatever it is, or test fixture or data file, anything. Is that you want import meta URL to be useful both on the local file system and on the web in order to find something relative to the physical location of the file. When you go through a bundle as an intermediate phase, there is no longer a sensible URL. The bundle is an intermediate artifact that could be executed in any environment on the web locally, and the URL would be useless if present. So there shouldn't be an import meta URL for something that's emerging from a bundle. Furthermore, for some of Agoric's use cases, it's extremely important not to convey the import meta URL that it had in its original physical location or its destination, because that would cause variation in the content of the archive that's created. The bundle shouldn't depend on which developer bundled it, right? It's like if it did have an import meta URL, it would contain a path that has the name of the user that created the bundle and the path to wherever they happened to clone the repository in their local file system. So erasing import meta URL is a feature of bundling, which is to say there do exist on the web module environments in which there isn't a sensible import meta URL, but still must have a sensible referrer, right? So the when you create a bundle, the referrers become a fiction of the bundle that is sufficient for the bundler's module system to link the artifacts that exist in the bundle, and is otherwise transparent and not visible. Pardon, it's otherwise invisible to user code, which is a good reason to have it hidden underneath another argument of the module constructor.
Okay, I think I'm fine. If we go to do that, should we then avoid? So it feels to me that we do that, we might be able to get away without having to pass the import meta in the constructor.
And it could be optional, yes.
I would say that is not even optional.
Wait. Hold on. I'm missing something there. First of all, I want to compliment you on your soliloquy just then. It was brilliantly clear, and I thought I understood all of this before, but I felt like I really understand it so much better now. So with regard to this latest thing, the module.
Oh, being... Mark, one moment. I see Jack's hand. I want to give Jack
sure. Time to speak.
So I support the current one because it requires the import hook to do the housekeeping work. It should. It might use a weak map to map the import meta objects to the fictionary referrer they need to. And since the import hook are doing the housekeeping work, we did not need to take care of the referrer in the language.
I think I'm fine. I mean, you can do the import the weak map, or you now can do a string value mapping. So you can still do like a mapping somehow. It might not be weak, but I don't think it will be a problem for many use cases. The thing that I like about this, thinking a little bit more, so it might solve multiple problems. So if we make this third argument here a string value, a referrals, whatever string, whatever the name will be, then we don't have to provide a construction path to provide the input meta object itself. We can just simply give you a getter to a ordinary object that is the import meta. You can populate it with whatever you want to populate. And that resolves the problem of that we were describing above of the virtualization of the import meta, because you're not going to create the object, we're going to create it for you, but you have the ability to extend that object by adding whatever you want to add to. And it doesn't have to be during construction, because people will not necessarily have to use the import meta that much.
Import meta might not be necessary for the module itself, but if we replace it with the module instance, now every module will have its module instance object. And if we pass it to the import hook, I think it might be better, because if you pass import meta, it might encourage the module system author to assess the import.meta.url on it.
I agree with you that it's very likely that the import hook should receive the instance of the module that is being operated on.
Say that again.
So if the import hook receive three arguments rather than two. The first argument to be the instance that is operating on, basically the instance that associated to it, which is normal for hooks. So you pass the instance as the first argument. Second argument will be the referral, just the third argument here. And the third argument that you pass to it will be the specifier, the new specifier, something like that. So that gives you the ability inside the import hook to do a weak map reference based on the module instance, or do a map based on the referral, or simply does just access the module.meta to access the meta object that will be accessible from within the source when that gets evaluated.
So we should not encourage they to access import meta.url because it might be overwritten by the module instance.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The evaluation. This is the module, a specifier, and not referral.
Yeah. Could we avoid ever saying module without an adjective? Module instance?
Yes. It happens in my brain. Every time that I say module, I say, I forgot the instance. So we could basically do something like so if this is the case of the import hook, that means that you can do weak map on top of it, which is what Jack was saying. If you have the referral and the specifier, you will not be able to do any weak, unless that you have some ways to figure out from this an instance and then use the instance as a weak or something like that. It's going to be a bit tricky.
For the record, I prefer the exact opposite or argument order, since you will definitely need the specifier.
It doesn't really matter the order. I'm not picking about the order.
Yeah.
So you can do a weak map on the module. You could do a module.meta.resolve if that's the thing that you want. If you know that's with the specifier, or you can just use what you normally would do, which is getting the referral plus the referral.
I'm sorry. What is module.meta?
This is the meta object created for the module instance. So basically, here, let me do it here. Cons and
that would be the import.meta that is seen module by the evaluated code for that instance.
You make
more. Are we proposing to make that a property of the module instance object?
That's what I was saying, that it might be easier that way, because when you do it that way, you allow them to put getters and setters or whatever they want on that object, but they don't create the object.
Yeah, which is to say that this is directly in contradiction to what Jack is saying, which is that the meta should not be visible to the import hook, because it would encourage people to write import hooks that vary based off of the content of meta.
Yeah, I'm trying to hide the meta object itself from the import hook.
Yeah, evil code might change the resolve function. And if you call it in the import hook,
so basically, so you will create a new module with a source, with the import hook, and you will pass a URL, most likely something like this. So far, so good on this line?
Yes.
Okay. And then if we don't pass the meta here, we could pass the meta here. But if we don't do that, because the problem with passing the meta is that how can we take the pieces out of the meta to create a new object? Cannot be a direct reference because of the proxy problem. So an alternative is to just have m.meta created by this construction path is empty right now. It's an object that is an instance of object. Doesn't have anything on it. It's empty. You need to
put prototype is null. Yeah.
There are
a few orthogonal concerns here that I think are on display.
Do you need the input method to be lazy?
Say that again.
Do we need the import method to be lazy? And I think the answer to that question is as specified for the evaluation of the import meta expression within a module's text, it is written lazy and we do not need to change that.
Yeah.
But what we do need to say is that any module record that is constructed through the module constructor must pre-initialize, it is in a position where it must pre-initialize the memo for the import meta of the module record.
Yeah. Right now we're doing it, but in this case, we just don't care. We just create an object, and that's the object that we give access to from the source, nothing else. They can do whatever they want with our object.
I'm lost in pronouns again. Who's the we and who's the they? Who's creating what and who's consuming what?
So the module source is going to access input.meta. It's going to access this exact object that was created by the engine during the construction of the module instance. That object is empty initially, and whoever created this instance, the owner of the module instance, will have access to modify the meta to do whatever they want with the meta.
This is instead of having an import meta argument on the module constructor.
Right, because having it as an argument then has the problem of the getters and setters.
Yeah.
So hold on. I think the problem of the getters and setters, I want to argue this is an artificial problem, because once we are passing strings to the import hook as the referrer, we no longer have a need to create a fresh import meta object. We no longer have a need to copy properties onto it. We no longer even need for it to be an object. It can just be, so go ahead and write it as a fourth argument to the module constructor. So fourth argument over there, just say import meta. No, not import dot meta, just import meta cap with mid cap. Yeah. So whatever is passed as that argument then becomes the thing that the module source, when the module source has an import.meta expression, that expression simply evaluates to whatever the value of that is. And if the value of that thing is undefined, then import.meta inside the module evaluates to undefined. There's really nothing else is coupled to it. Nothing else. It's just completely parametric, completely opaque with regard to everything else, because the only purpose of the argument to the constructor is to pass through a value to be bound to the evaluation of the import.meta expression. That has no other role.
Okay, so I don't think that will fly, because if you do this, This can be a rejected promise.
Yeah.
And now there might be some issues for implementers. I'm speculating here, but I believe there is a intrinsic invariant right now based on the spec that we're seeing, that when you access import meta, you can access things off of import meta and it will never throw an error. So basically in any source today, when you do import.meta dot, whatever you're doing, it will never throw an error, because that object is a object controlled by the engine.
Oh no, that's not the case. It's that the evaluation of the import meta expression can never throw an error.
That one should never throw an error for sure. But then now today, as today, also never throw an error.
Okay, hold on. I'm confused. Are you saying that it is impossible for the host to create an import.meta object for which import.meta foo is an accessor that throws?
Yeah.
That's correct.
That is correct. expressly the opposite of what we learned about the finalization hook from Niccolo this morning, where browsers are expressly in installing accessors and setters on import meta, or at least accessors on import meta, that could throw. They don't, but they could.
Yeah.
Yep.
So, okay, so is there anything in the 262 spec that that guarantees that the expression import.meta.foo does not throw?
No.
No.
Okay. Then why, then it's up to the host to have a policy for what it populates import meta with and whether those things can throw.
Yeah, but it is also an incidental invariant of the way that the spec is written today, that import meta is guaranteed to be an object.
Okay, it's guaranteed to be an object, but the properties of it are not guaranteed not to throw.
That's correct.
Okay.
Yeah.
So why is it of value? So it would be a normative change to say that we allow import.meta not to be an object. But I just don't see why that's a problem.
To be clear, I don't either. But my understanding is rooted in the assumption that we do have a referrer string that is separate from the import meta. And,
right. Yes, that's clearly the assumption under which we're engaged in this part of the discussion.
Yeah.
That the third argument to the module constructor on line 10 is the referrer string. And the fourth argument is just the opaque import meta value, whatever the hell it is, and it gets passed through opaquely. And then it's just the business of a given module system and the sources that run under the module system to coordinate on the meaning of that, like it is anyway. And then we can completely avoid this issue about, are we copying properties with assigned semantics or copying properties with defined semantics? What if okay. the object
is from the I'm fine with trying that and see how far we can go.
Yeah.
Okay, great.
Yeah. That's I think that's the best we can ask for.
Do we want this to be tested as an object or to be whatever?
I think it's just whatever. There's nothing that should, nothing in this, in our mechanism that should ever look at the value. It should just pass it through.
Okay. So the last question then will be, do we want this to be the first argument?
I think that Jack's point is that we should not. Especially in the case where where we expose the dot meta property on the module instance. My feeling is that import hook should receive specifier and referral only, referrer with an R on the end only. Though like deliberately misspelling referrer is funny for reasons. I don't know if everybody here knows this, but in HTTP, the HTTP specification famously misspells refer with one R.
I'm okay dropping this as well. I mean, we don't have it right now. The reason why I'm okay with that is because this could be valid and it should probably be a guard against, which we should do regardless.
Yeah, that seems, yeah.
I think we should, I will add the guarding against this because I don't think this is possible. I might be wrong.
And my position is the import hook should only receive the specifier and the module instance nothing else, and the meta and the import meta property should not be exposed on the module instance, so we can enforce the author to write weak map semantics to do the housekeeping work.
So
one part of it, I'm fine. Like we're saying, we're not going to give you the meta. I'm fine with that. The other part I didn't quite get. You're saying module, referral, and specifier, or you're saying module and specifier only?
Jack is saying specifier and module instance only. And the implication is that the module instance is usable as an opaque handle to obtain the referrer. My position, and I believe Mark's position, is that the referrer should be expressly threaded and that the module instance provides access authority.
Well, you could create a, you can subclass the module and do your own module with referral.
Yeah, in the same way that you can do that with the import meta. I agree that it is possible to arrange everything that we want, but I think that the most direct and obvious thing to do is specifier and refer. From having a great deal of experience implementing import hooks that only ever need those two strings in any environment.
Before we get into the referral, are we okay with these or not? First argument, module, first argument.
I would prefer to omit it. I would prefer the module to be not an argument to the import hook.
I would prefer to omit it as well. I do think that obviously we have to have the specifier, that's no question. And I think the referrer or the module, it should be one or the other. And for the reasons Chris explained, I prefer the referrer. But I agree with Jack that if we're going to have the module there, it should be in the role of referrer. So we should not have both.
Yes, I agree. And I also strongly feel that the specifier must be the first argument because it will always be necessary for any implementation of an import hook, that the referrer should be the second argument because it is possible to construct a module graph where the referrer is. But if you create a module environment in which relative specifiers are not possible, then it is not necessary to consult the referrer.
I need to write it down because it's getting confused. So we're saying this is the no goal. We're saying this is no goal.
Right.
We're saying that this one is possible.
But with a preference even for that one of reversing the arguments because the module is in the role of refer.
Okay, like this.
Yep.
But the hooks normally pass the instance of the first argument, for sure. And then we're talking about this one where referral is also the second argument.
Correct. And I would say that these three are in my reverse preference order. That the number two is the one that I want us to do. Number one, I understand the rationale for. The NO one is. I think is just too much information.
Here will be something like, so you would do module.referral here, and you will have to do a class module.referral extends module, and it has a get referral. I return something or a value, could be just a value.
Okay, so that makes me even more eager to avoid option number one because I don't want to add a refer property to the module.
No, you don't need that. You please create a weak map to store that.
But that's unnecessary complication.
Yeah, but I'll argue that this one is better in the sense that you have the weak map semantics available to you right there. You're getting an instance of the thing that is calling this. You can figure out a bunch of things out of that. You only have this information, then you cannot be weak anymore.
Yeah. No. You'll never need to be. You will never need to be.
Oh, you can't be weak.
No, the point that about the weak map that I think Jack and I agree on is that we don't want the module object to expose a referrer, but if we're going to use the module object in lieu of a referrer, in the role of a referrer, then the import hook, that an import hook logic where that wants a string referrer value has to recover it somehow from module object. We do not want to expose it as a public property on the module object. And yes, therefore the import hook in that case needs to be part of the system in which it has access to a shared weak map in which those module objects are registered and associated with referrers, so that something inside that system, thereby with access to the weak map, can recover that string, but something outside the system with only the module object and not the weak map cannot recover the string.
So to be clear, I think that this makes a stronger case for number two. Because number one puts you in a position where to correctly satisfy all of the requirements that Mark suggests, you have to use a weak map side table, which is not something that anybody's going to reach for in a naive implementation of an import hook. That they will inevitably put the referrer as a property of an expando property on the module instance. And also,
I'm still not clear, Chris, on how do you achieve anything weak with these two things?
You will never.
The point of the weak was not so that so that you have a table in which to look up the referrer. The point of the weak is so that whatever is used in the role of referrer, the import hook internally can recover the referrer string that it would then do whatever URL arithmetic it wants to do. So if the logic what needs the string, but was provided in lieu of the string is an object, then the weak map is the way to get from the object to the string. If you provide the string, then you don't need the map.
So also, as Luca pointed out in chat, the specifier, comma, referrer is the normal argument order for a resolve function, and also specifically the URL constructor, which serves as a resolve function. So this, by making the arguments to import hook B, specifier, comma, referrer, we are creating a strong hint that the first line of an import hook is almost always going to be something of the shape new location equals new URL specifier, comma, referrer. That like even the names match the URL constructor documentation.
Okay, so it's saying then we go with this one.
Yep. Yeah.
This one and this one.
Yep. Yeah, and also just like while digging in, I really think that the argument order for the module constructor should be source, because it will always be required, followed by the referrer, which will always be required. And then the import hook and import meta, I think that it would be fitting to have an options bag for those, because let's make that the topic for the next meeting. I think that we're sufficiently over time. I think that at least source, comma, refer, comma, to be decided.
Okay. Yeah. I have other intuitions about the order of the arguments, but if we've narrowed the remaining controversy to order of arguments, we have made great progress.
Yeah. Okay.
I have two concerns with the second past. The first one is if I am going to have some anonymous modules, I need to think of some nonsense referrer string in order to call the API.
Yeah, that's fine.
A null string should suffice for all such cases.
And the second one is if it is a refer, developer
Jack, sorry. We do need to clarify that the refer may be null. There are cases on the web where the refer must be null.
We don't care about what it is. We just pass it around. Similar to meta, we just pass it around.
Okay.
This is the only one that has to be callable.
Okay. Go ahead, Jack. Sorry for interrupting.
People might think it is a normalized version. Version of a specifier that they can use in the host, but it might not be the case. I think it may bring confusion.
So that it?
Let's say it's called as a refer for every module, and developer might think that refer can be used as a real specifier when they want to import something natively.
Well,
that's the thing. That's what I was explaining during the call, or when we were talking about the spec. You can never have an import hook defined by a user that will be called for a module record that is not associated to an instance. It always has to be an instance. It has to be user land. Import hook is only for user land stuff. So right. You get import hook to be called is because you create an instance with that import hook.
Yeah, any other module record has a different implementation of the host defined import behavior.
Yeah,
I think that we ought to call it a meeting at this point. We're a little bit over time, and let's put on the agenda for next week a discussion about digging into the intuitions about the subsequent arguments of the module constructor and whether to provide the import meta property on module instances as Carity invented over in this call, which I think is a good idea.
Really? You think it's a good idea?
Yeah, let's talk about that next week. All right, I'm going to stop recording.
If we are going to rename the refer to something like identity, it might be good to me.
I could be convinced. No, I can't. But we'll talk about it again next week. Stopping recording. Thank you, everyone.